Good evening, everyone, and welcome. My name is Janine Pollock, the Chief of Special Collections here at the Free Library of Philadelphia. Before we proceed further, I'd like to acknowledge that the Free Library is in Lenape Hoking, the original territory of the Lenai Lenape peoples. The Lenape Nation's rightful relationship with their ancestral homeland continues, both for those who were forcefully displaced and for those who remain here today. As the efforts of colonization are ongoing, institutions like the Free Library have a responsibility to take actions that support healing, reconciliation, and Indigenous futures, which we are sincerely committed to doing through growing partnerships and programming. Tonight we are here to celebrate the opening of Translating Science, the 15th annual Lawrence J. Schoenberg Symposium on Manuscript Studies in the Digital Age. We are happy to have you here both in person and over Zoom. The Free Library has been partnering with the Schoenberg Institute for Manuscript Studies on this program for nearly all of its 15 years, except for that 1 year when we took a break. Our relationship with Penn goes beyond this annual event, though. Penn brings us researchers from undergraduate students to the most seasoned scholars who deepen our understanding of our collections with their discoveries. I want to acknowledge my gratitude to the staff of the Rare Book Department, who not only have hosted you so graciously tonight, but who welcome so many of you into our reading room. And now it is my sincere pleasure to introduce Sean Quimby, Kislak Center for Special Collections, Rare Books, and Manuscripts. Director of the Kislak Center for Special Collections, Rare Books, and Manuscripts at Penn Libraries. Please join me in welcoming Sean.
Thank you, Janine. I have several titles, actually. I think the most concise one is Associate University Librarian for Special Collections, but that means that I have oversight of the Schoenberg Institute for Manuscript Studies, something that I am very proud to do my best to provide. So on behalf of the University of Pennsylvania, I want to thank you all for joining us, and I want to thank the Free Library for hosting us this evening. As Janine said, this partnership extends back several years, apparently 15. And it's just one example of the brotherly love that binds our city's bibliophilic community together. And as I begin my third year here at Penn, I've come to believe that this spirit of collaboration within and across the city is truly unique and worth nurturing and celebrating. So yes, this is the 15th Schoenberg Symposium, and I gather that many of you are veterans by now. But for those of you who might be new to it, I want to say a few brief words about SIMS. Established in 2011 to mark a transformational gift of pre-modern manuscripts by Larry and Barbara Schoenberg, it's pithily described as a think tank for manuscript studies and a place where manuscripts, technology, and people come together. SIMS sponsors technology-driven projects like the reimagining of digital scriptorium and the continued development of the Schoenberg database of manuscripts, and a scholarly journal, Manuscript Studies, rich public programming, like tonight, and a variety of other forms of teaching and outreach. It, however, is really they. They being the team of uniquely talented individuals, including Lynn Ransom, Nick Herman, Dot Porter, Amy Hutchins, Mitch Frass, Doug Emery, Jesse Dummer, and many others, whose combined skills make SIMS so much more than the sum of its individual parts. So please join me in acknowledging the SIMS team for all that they do to advance the field of manuscript studies. And I'll add here that Barbara Brisdell Schoenberg typically joins us and had every intention of doing so this evening, but unfortunately, Tropical Storm Nicole had other plans. I know, since she's texted me, that Barbara is out there in Zoom land and will be joining us remotely these next few days. Before I hand things over to my colleague Nick Herman, I thought I might offer a few thoughts on our symposium's theme. I've been reading Jonathan Rauch's recent book, The Constitution of Knowledge, A Defense of Truth, which has as its subject the epistemic crisis that we in the second decade of the 21st century seem to be facing, a crisis that is perhaps best exemplified by the neologism alternative facts. Rauch reminds us that philosophers have long held that science, or even more broadly, knowledge-making, is fundamentally social in nature and depends on certain shared behavioral norms and beliefs like falsifiability, and that media plays an essential role in binding those norms and things together. He's more interested in Wikipedia and Twitter than in the printing press or the scriptorium, but I can't help but draw parallels to the theme of our symposium. How has the manuscript form not only helped to translate science from one language to another, but from one individual to the next, carrying with it implicitly or explicitly rules for how knowledge itself might be created? I realize this is too big a question for any one paper or any one symposium to answer, but that's the lens through which I'll be following the proceedings of the next few days. And so with that, I want to thank each and every one of the scholars, many of whom are in the audience right now, who are participating in helping us to better understand the matters, both big and small, that relate to the topic at hand, translating silence. So thank you to all of our scholars. And with that, I will turn things over to Nick Herman, the Larry J. Schoenberg Curator of Manuscripts. Nick.
Thank you. Thank you, Sean and Janine, for starting us off this evening. As Sean said, my name is Nicholas Herman. I'm the Lawrence J. Schoenberg Curator at the Schoenberg Institute for Manuscript Studies at Penn Libraries, and it's a real pleasure tonight to be able to introduce our speaker and our keynote for the 15th Annual Schoenberg Symposium, Professor Elly Truitt. Tonight's event and the following 2 days of exciting symposium talks by our broad range of speakers encapsulate the synergy of scholarship, collections, and programming that we endeavor to produce at SIMS. Our speaker, too, is in many ways a figurehead for this translating science event. Professor Truitt, Elly, joined the Department of the History of Sociology and Science as associate professor at Penn in 2020. Affecting her own Translatio from nearby Bryn Mawr College, so not too far away, where she taught for over a decade. Her presence at Penn has really strengthened and enhanced our vibrant community of scholars of the pre-modern world. And what is more, like the subject of this year's symposium, Elly's interests in pre-modern science closely parallel the strengths of the extraordinary Lawrence J. Schoenberg collection of manuscripts, the collection that my colleagues and I oversee. Whose focus is the conveyance of practical knowledge from antiquity through the Islamic world and eventually into the Latin and vernacular textual traditions of Western Europe. And highlights from our collection that pertain to many of the talks you will hear over the next few days will be on view tomorrow and Saturday at the Kislak Center at Penn. So prior to becoming a member of its faculty, Elly was no stranger to Penn. We welcomed her as a visiting fellow at the Schoenberg Institute in 2018 and 2019, as she completed a New Directions Fellowship from the Andrew W. Mellon Foundation, which she employed to gain a working knowledge of medieval Arabic. Professor Truitt's first monograph, Medieval Robots, Mechanism, Magic, Nature, and Art, was published by our own University of Pennsylvania Press in 2015, and it's as close to a bestseller as anything within the realm of medieval studies could be in this day and age. And the text has rapidly become an icon of genre-busting relevance, reviewed in dozens of publications, and praised, of course, by humanists and historians, but also by scientists, technologists, and even gamers, apparently. So in Medieval Robots, Truitt reveals not just the what of the medieval of medieval automata, but also the how and the why. That is to say, by interrogating an amazing variety of sources, she manages to excavate the voices of medieval scientists, practitioners, and observers who use the idea of the complex machine to think through fundamental questions of agency, humanity, and free will. Professor Truitt's forthcoming book, entitled Marvelous Inventions, Roger Bacon, the Middle Ages, and the Making of Modern Science, will explore this key practitioner's theory of experimental knowledge and its afterlives in scholarship and culture in order to problematize the traditional role the Middle Ages plays in broader interpretations of the history of science. Tonight, she will give us a glimpse of yet another project on Chaucer's overlooked linguistic contributions, not to literary narratives, but to proto-scientific vocabularies. By examining the interplay of language, pedagogy, and experience, her address this evening will remind us that knowledge production is always a combined product of each of these fields. Please join me in welcoming Elly Truitt.
Thank you so much for that generous introduction, Nick, and thank you also to Lynn for the invitation to speak here, and also to Lynn, Nick, and all your colleagues at SIMS for this tradition of putting on these incredible symposia. I came to the first one that I came to is in 2008, which may have, so I've been coming to these for a long time, and it's a real pleasure to be here today in this role, able to address, I don't know, my people. So thank you for that. So I want to just give you guys a little bit of a sort of overview of this evening, and then I will dive right in. So the first thing I'm going to say is that I know that there is usually a convention among scholars of Middle English to, when giving talks, to give the, like, to read the Middle English in the original language. I'm not going to be doing that this evening because we are not here to just address scholars of Middle English. So, however, the Middle English original will be up on the slides. I'm going to be talking this evening about Chaucer's treatise on the Astrolabe as a translation, but also as a work of innovation. And the sort of course of this evening's talk is going to involve a sort of general introduction into, like, what is an astrolabe, text related to the astrolabe, and then get into the Arabic terms and the role of Arabic and the terms that Chaucer ends up using, as well as the importance of the concept of experience, knowledge from the sensorium. And then, finally, I will turn to manuscripts. All right, so this pithy little quote, if you were a Latin treatise, I would put you in the vernacular. This is, this comes to us from a blog written in the voice of Geoffrey Chaucer, and this came from a posting on pickup lines at Kalamazoo, to good pickup lines to use at Kalamazoo, which is the major sort of congress of medievalists in North America that happens every year in May. And I put this up here because, of course, it speaks to the theme of this evening, but also just to note, this is from 2006, and I also kind of want to just make it clear, this is also something, I put this in here because I've been working on this project since 2007 when I made the ill-advised decision to take a seminar, a graduate seminar, while I was finishing my dissertation, a decision that we could say that this project entirely kind of emerges as an attempt, or really a need, to recuperate that decision. So, yes, this has been with me for a long time. Better?
Yeah.
We'll see. Okay. Hey, everyone. So, Chaucer's reputation for inventiveness and impact in Middle English literature results in part from his reputation as a translator of texts across language and genre into Middle English. So Chaucer rendered Boethius's Consolation of Philosophy from Latin into English as Boes. Likewise, another text emblematic of Christian Neoplatonism, The Romance of the Rose, translated from French into English as The Romance of the Rose. He based his Troilus and Criseyde on Boccaccio's Il Filostrato, which was itself based on a portion of the old French Roman des Trois by Benoît de Saint-Maur. Yet despite the many instances in which Chaucer translated others' work into English, he seems to have discussed the role of the translator only once, in the prologue to his treatise on the Astrolabe. He wrote the treatise, likely in parts, between 1391 and 93, in the last decade of his life, the same decade that saw the completion of Canterbury Tales, the only work of Chaucer's that has survived in more manuscript copies than the treatise. After over two decades spent translating literary, historical, and philosophical work, as well as composing original material, Chaucer explicitly addressed the role and purpose of the translator in his last work of translation, the treatise. The treatise is a paradoxical text. For example, the prologue to the treatise is the longest example of surviving original prose by Chaucer, yet it appears at the start of a translation and takes translation as its subject. Chaucer's original prose unfolds in an extended consideration of the essentially conservative work of the translator. Secondly, Chaucer addressed the treatise to a child and simultaneously a wider audience of educated, interested readers. In the prologue, he frames the treatise a clear how-to guide for using an astrolabe to take accurate measurements and a lesson on cosmology as a primer for his 10-year-old son, Lewis. Adopting a parental role in this didactic text, Chaucer both employs an established literary topos in philosophical literature, the letter to your son, and also uses Lewis as a stand-in for his English audience, thereby making himself the father of English technological and astral knowledge. Yet he also humbly characterizes himself as untutored and a mere compiler of others' work, which he has rendered into English only for the private undertaking of instructing his young son. I am only an unlearned compiler of the work of older astrologers and have translated it into my own English only for your own teaching, he writes. In addition to the links between the treatise and medical and scientific miscellanies and compilations that it accompanied often in manuscript books, and I'll return to that later, it's also possible to read the treatise on the astrolabe itself as a compilation or assemblage of existing texts in other languages. Thirdly, Chaucer uses the concept of translation with its implied sense of movement, as well as familial metaphors of paternity and adoption to articulate the importance of language to political identity, writing, "God save the king, that lord of this language." But Chaucer did not invoke a familiar topos of Translatio Studii in the prologue, in which the author represents his efforts as translating a tale from antiquity. Instead, he articulated a concept that I call Translatio Scientiae, the transfer of natural knowledge from one language to another, one culture to another, one register to another. Just as Translatio Imperii refers to more than the shift in centers of temporal power from Rome to Constantinople or Aachen, and Translatio Studii encompasses more than the movement of knowledge from Greece to Rome to France, Translatio Scientiae refers to more than merely the translation of scientific material from Arabic or Greek into Latin and Latin into a European vernacular. I also use this term to include the transfer of scientific knowledge in terms of scientific objects like the astrolabe and also in terms of translated texts like the treatise. So in this text, Chaucer translates knowledge across multiple boundaries, and by doing so, He presents mine English, he says, as a scientific language for undertaking and communicating complex natural inquiry, one that combines text-based learning, mathematical calculation, and direct participation. So this evening, I'm just going to explore this concept of Translatio Scientiae by tracing the ways that Chaucer embraced experiential knowledge, especially because astrolabes and them themselves work according to direct participation. And then I examine how his vocabularies, whether translated or adopted, offered new possibilities for using English as a language for scientific knowledge, and for articulating and even creating new communities of scientific readers and practitioners. And I also explore how Chaucer articulated and emphasized experience, a concept taken from 13th century natural philosophy, as a necessary component of requiring natural knowledge. Using the astrolabe is as important as reading about it. I demonstrate that while he maintained the centrality of experiential knowledge to understand nature, Chaucer also argues for English as a scientific language, ultimately suggesting that the concept of experience and the role of the English language in scientific inquiry are themselves linked. So, in Chaucer's treatise, the astrolabe is the vehicle that combines text-based knowledge with experience, a term that Chaucer employed in English in several contexts, including confirming or proving natural knowledge via the senses. The Latin texts, the works of older astrologers on which he based his treatise, were based in part on older Arabic works that were based on or in conversation with older Greek material. Indeed, Chaucer explicitly invokes this lineage of Translatio Studii in the prologue, even as he also is trying to do something different. So as he writes, the conclusions of the astrolabe that he sets out in English are the same as will suffice to these noble Greek scholars, the same conclusions in Greek, and to Arabians in Arabic, and to Jews in Hebrew, and to Latin folk in Latin. These four languages are all holy languages, as well as languages for communicating natural knowledge, especially the science of the stars. Moreover, the astrolabe is an instrument that helps to produce or acquire natural knowledge via experience. This word, which Chaucer may have introduced into English, refers to knowledge acquisition, especially through sensory stimuli. With the treatise, Chaucer claims that scientia, or advanced natural knowledge, is as much English knowledge as it is Arabic or Latin knowledge, and highlights the importance of participation and observation, of experience, for gaining scientific literacy, and the role of instruments in confirming that experience. So the astrolabe has a long history of transmission and translation. It is roughly 2,000 years old, an instrument that is usually made of brass, ranging from the size of your palm to about the size of a dinner plate. And it's for measuring the position and altitude of celestial bodies, to calculate time, or to establish location on Earth. It's used in conjunction with planetary tables, which record the altitude for celestial bodies at particular latitudes. And these tables are themselves separate from manuals on how to use an astrolabe. The astrolabe makes it possible, okay, to move from qualitative observation. So for example, noting the appearance of a particular celestial body over the horizon. And then you can move to quantitative observation, numeric measurement that corresponds to the geometrical framework of spherical astronomy. The astrolabe is also a physical manifestation of that geometrical framework. It comprises a star map called a reet on the front, onto which the ecliptic is the term for the path that the sun appears to take in the sky from the position of an observer on Earth. It includes the equinoxes, the solstices that are projected onto a plane, and a plate for the local horizon, or in many cases, multiple plates for multiple places. And these plates are also often called climates. Ptolemy wrote in the second century about an instrument which may have been an early astrolabe, but he was using the works of prior astronomers and mathematicians. And the earliest extant account of the astrolabe that we have is by John Philoponus, the Neoplatonist philosopher and cosmologist who flourished in Alexandria in the 5th and 6th centuries. Greek-speaking Nestorian Christians who had settled in the Arabian Peninsula introduced the astrolabe to that geographic area. And as more areas that had been previously under Byzantine political control came under Arabic Muslim control in the 7th and 8th centuries, the astrolabe and the knowledge of how to use it became a source and site of great scientific inquiry.
Arabic scholars in the 7th and 8th centuries and later, refined the instrument and introduced new astronomical observations and calculations. It first appeared as an object in the Latin Christian West in the second half of the 10th century. Scholars at religious institutions, monasteries, recognized the utility of the astrolabe as an instrument for reckoning time. So it's possible to use an astrolabe to calculate time in two different ways. You can use it to calculate what are called equal hours. This is a term for when a single turn of the celestial sphere is divided into 24 equal hours. You can also use an astrolabe to divide the day into unequal hours, in which the day is divided into two periods of variable length, sunrise to sunset and sunset to sunrise. And each of those periods comprises 12 unequal hours. This latter is what is more customary in monastic institutions. In addition, the astrolabe can also be used to reckon larger units of time, like the lunar cycles that are necessary for determining the correct date of Easter. This is a branch of mathematical reckoning and knowledge called computus. In both the Arabic and Latin traditions, correct measurement of the position of the stars and planets was also critical to prognostication, even if the definition of an acceptable astral prediction changed according to context. Over time, and with the advent of universities in the Latin Christian West, the sciences of the stars, including how to use an astrolabe, developed a more formal curriculum. And astrolabes, though still very costly, became more familiar to a wider group of people and might be found at court or in the home of a wealthy physician. Just like the instrument itself, texts about the astrolabe have a history stretching back over 1,000 years before Chaucer in multiple cultures and languages. In translating works in Latin on the astrolabe, Chaucer was himself part of a much larger genealogy of translation, a genealogy that reflects the traffic of knowledge in texts and instruments across Eurasia throughout the medieval period. Arabic scholars grappled with the texts on the astrolabe that were written in Greek, translated them into Arabic, and then wrote new texts that challenged, amplified, and elaborated on these earlier works. Arabic then joined Greek as a language for the learned, highly theorized natural philosophy and flourished for centuries throughout Africa and Asia for this purpose, except in the Latin Christian West. In that part of Eurasia, especially over the late 11th, 12th, and 13th centuries, works in Arabic were instead translated and abridged into Latin. They became assimilated into a Christian intellectual framework through scholars located in monastery and cathedral schools, and then later in universities. Chaucer's two main sources for his own treatise were the Latin translations of earlier works in Arabic. One, De Composizione e Operazioni Astrolabii, on the composition and working of the astrolabe, is a Latin translation of a text attributed to Masha'Allah ibn Athari, a late 8th century, 2nd century, Judeo-Arabic astronomer based in Basra, but it is in fact actually a compilation of multiple sources. The other text, the Latin Tractatus of Mesphera, the work on the sphere, by Johannes Sacrobosco, also called John of Holywood, itself owes a large debt to Al-Farghani's Kitab fi al-Jawami al-Ilm al-Nujum, the elements of astronomy, from roughly the same period as Masha'Allah ibn Athari's work. Al-Farghani's work was enormously influential and copied explication of Ptolemy's much earlier Almagest from the 2nd century, and it was produced at the Abbasid court of Al-Ma'mun. Al-Farghani's work was then translated into Latin from Arabic in the 12th century and attributed to Al-Farghanos. Chaucer was also the beneficiary of centuries of interest in astral science within England. Some texts on astral science had been translated into Latin early, originally written in Latin and studied in the great monasteries of early medieval England. The Venerable Bede's treatise on computus, on the reckoning of time, circa 700, was widely used for centuries afterward in the Roman Church. And Alcuin, who came just a generation after Bede, wrote of the education in astral science that he had received while a student in York, when later tasked with replicating that curriculum for the Carolingian Empire. beginning in the late 11th and early 12th centuries, after gradual diffusion into the Latin West over the previous century, scholars in England engaged with new treatises on astral science introduced from Al-Andalus and Christian-ruled Spain. Scholars from those regions traveled with texts on astral science and astronomical tables to England, and there they found a group of interested pupils who were based mainly in cathedral schools and monasteries in the West Country of England. English scholars also traveled to Iberia and Sicily in order to gain access to the wealth of texts relating to the sciences of the quadrivium, arithmetic, geometry, music, and astral sciences. In later centuries, England remained an important point of entry for scientific texts from Spain and North Africa due to existing diplomatic ties. And Chaucer may also have been influenced by a more contemporary French manual on how to use an astrolabe. The Pratique d'Astrolabe by Pellerin de Prusse was written at the request of the future king, who's at the time the Dauphin, Charles V, and completed in 1362. Like Chaucer's treatise, the Pratique is not as advanced as a university text and is pitched to the educated, interested courtier. Moreover, both texts rely on the Latin version of Mashallah as a source. So the treatise itself. Chaucer intended his text to be read alongside an astrolabe, fusing a sensory experience with text-based learning, and he meant it to reach a wider group of interested readers beyond the cloister or the classroom. In addition to writing in English, Chaucer mentioned an astrolabe keyed to Oxford, which further heightened the link between knowledge of astral science and England as a place. He stated in the prologue that his aim was to educate his 10-year-old son in the use of the astrolabe, having already sent to him in Oxford an astrolabe compounded after that latitude. Used in tandem then with the treatise, the astrolabe would teach a certain number of conclusions appertaining to that same instrument, he writes. After the prologue, so the treatise, you have the prologue, and then the treatise goes into an explanation of different parts of the astrolabe and how to use it for various purposes. And it kind of increases in difficulty in the second part. After these exercises, Chaucer planned, but did not complete, three other parts. So a compendium of astronomical tables of the type you would need to use with an astrolabe that were based on the works of two eminent Oxonian astronomers, John Summer and Nicholas of Lynn. Then also a theory of planetary and celestial motion, and finally a general theory of astral divination. I personally really wish he'd written that last one. The named audience, Chaucer's son, Lewis, stands in for the community of readers and audience of the treatise. Written according to Chaucer in answer to Lewis's beseeching, busy prayer and his evident ability to learn sciences touching numbers and propositions, Chaucer proposed to teach him how to use the instrument in English, for as he says, the Latin that you have is very small. By the late 14th century, Latin was well established as a scientific language, as well as the language for statecraft, history, and the church, especially after the appearance of universities which took Latin as their shared language. Treatises on natural philosophy, medicine, astral science, botany, and optics were all written in Latin. But also texts on these subjects, as well as theology and history, began more commonly to appear in vernacular languages over the course of the 14th century. But even if Lewis's Latin was excellent, said Chaucer, some of the texts are too advanced for a 10-year-old to apprehend. So therefore, Chaucer writes, he needs to convey complicated concepts in a more approachable tone. And this textual invocation of Lewis indicates, right, that a bright and curious child was a useful stand-in for the type of intellectual background and abilities of the audience that Chaucer was imagining. And he, in fact, makes it clear that his audience is not only Lewis, but also every single person who hears or reads the treatise, suggesting an English audience even outside the court. And even despite its didactic tone, neither was the treatise intended for a university student or graduate specifically. Students in astronomy at Oxford or Cambridge or elsewhere would learn this material in Latin, studying Sacrobosco's treatise on the sphere as their first introduction, and then they would move to more elaborate and difficult texts, including Latin versions of Ptolemy's Almagest and Aristotle's De Chilo. In this treatise and elsewhere, in the Canterbury Tales, House of Fame, and some of his shorter poems, Chaucer clearly demonstrates his own level of familiarity with planetary astronomy. He knows how to use an astrolabe, how to tell time and reckon the seasons, as well as having a fairly extensive, if not necessarily exhaustive, understanding of the order and movement of the spheres. So the material in the treatise is fairly technical, but not beyond that of an educated adult like Chaucer himself. So Chaucer identified the multiple and simultaneous types of translation that he proposed to undertake, from Latin into English, and making highly specialized knowledge more easily comprehensible and useful to non-specialists. Rather than focusing simply on expression, Chaucer here prioritizes communication, which is audience-centered and is based always on the strongest language that both the speaker and the writer and the audience have in common. This is called the vehicular language because it is the language that carries or translates concept from the speaker or writer to the audience. So Chaucer uses, as he said, naked words in English as the vehicular language to convey knowledge about the astrolabe to interested, if untutored, audiences. And these simultaneous translations of language and register, right, are linked to one another by the use of this audience persona of Lewis. Chaucer addresses Lewis directly, both in the prologue and elsewhere in the treatise, but he also addresses an audience of unnamed, well-informed individuals whom he asks to forgive the prose style he has adopted to suit his young son. Now I will pray, make every single person that read or hears this little treatise to have my rude words for excused and this superfluity of words. So he writes, by virtue of being, you know, written in English rather than Latin, and the treatise then is aimed at this audience beyond the confines of the lecture hall or the chapter house to courtly and professional elites. And the manuscript evidence, as I will show, I think bears out this characterization of the audience. So Translatio Scientiae rests in part on the assumption that because the laws of nature are inherently universal, it is possible to translate natural knowledge from one language to another with total equivalency. Chaucer argues that English is suitable as a scientific language, and he is suitable as a translator of this material because the language in which scientific conclusions are expressed does not alter the conclusions themselves. He resolves, he says, to write his treatise under full light rules and naked words in English, introducing the astrolabe and the conclusions to which it can be turned, and goes over the parts of the astrolabe, their names and functions, and sets out a set of problems or questions the proper use of the astrolabe can answer. So the scholar Andrew Cole has argued that Chaucer employed this concept of naked words to make a case for a particularly English kind of translation as a political necessity. So Cole says that by engaging with Wycliffeite models of translation, Chaucer introduced into his own canon a number of new and specialized idioms that were derived from what was itself a new body of knowledge. In fact, Chaucer yokes this claim to Englishness, he yokes this to a philosophical position that is still commonly held, that scientific knowledge is universal, and so the same in all languages. And this assumption rests on the idea that the conclusions of natural knowledge are a true or unfiltered picture of the natural world. This idea is believed to be particularly true for the mathematical sciences, such as astral observation and calculation required by the astrolabe. But nonetheless, suffice that these true conclusions in English, as well as suffice to these noble scholars in Greek, these same conclusions in Greek, and to Arabians in Arabic, and to Jews in Hebrew, and to the Latin folk in Latin. It does not matter in what tongue one encounters the astrolabe and uses it, because its conclusions are the same in all of them. The same text in different languages will still convey the correct information or sense to its audience, just as diverse paths need diverse folk the right way to roam. Chaucer uses the assumption of universal scientific knowledge to strengthen his claim that English is then sufficient as a scientific language, just as he used the geographic specificity that the astrolabe requires to locate scientific knowledge and practice in England. But the possibility of successful translation and perfect communication relies on accurate copies of texts. Earlier writers in natural philosophy faced with new texts from Latin into Latin, from Arabic and Greek, worried about the potential for misinformation and error that faulty translations could foster. So for example, Roger Bacon decried erroneous translations and lamented the havoc they could cause. He was really, really worried about this. Innovation or ignorance in translation, both, could produce erroneous conclusions and in some instances could lead you to heretical ideas. Bacon warned of the dangers of thought and belief that could arise when translation was based in error. In particular, he was concerned about the introduction of new terms from Arabic and to a lesser extent Hebrew to describe concepts in natural philosophy, for example, unfamiliar concepts or new ideas, or objects in nature, like plants, animals, substances, or phenomena that were new or otherwise unfamiliar to a learned Latin audience in texts that had been translated. So how would it be possible to understand the untranslated term if the concept or object in Latin or Latin Christian vernacular was entirely unfamiliar? He really worked on that a lot. But Chaucer, the inventive and adept English writer who gave us a number of new English words, including the word newfangled, opted not to translate several Arabic terms related to the astrolabe and its operation, instead adopting these words into English and making them part of the language. Chaucer retained the Arabic terms for some parts of the astrolabe as well as measurements that are taken with it. And these terms are all Latinized spellings of Arabic words: Omri, Alidad, Azimuts, Elmicanteras, and Sanath. These are specific terms whose links to Arabic renders them more scientale, more scholarly, than a neologism or a repurposed word might. And although John of Trevisa seems to have used Sanath in his translation of Ranulf Higdon's Encyclopedia Polychronicon in 1387, just a few years before it appears in the treatise, the other terms make their first appearances in English in the treatise on the astrolabe. Having already declared that he will use naked words in English to write his treatise, Chaucer then promptly includes these foreign words, each with a highly specific and technical meaning. By not translating them, he adopts them into the language and makes them into naked English words. And this concept of adoption rather than translation here, I think, subtly echoes the familial logic of the treatise and the astrolabe. So the text itself is written as a gift from father to son. And the main plate of the astrolabe onto which the thinner plates and dials are attached is called the mother because, as Chaucer wrote, it receives in her womb the thin plates compounded for diverse climates. By adopting Arabic terms into the King's English, Chaucer incorporated those words into English, making them available to the political and linguistic community or family of English speakers. At the same time, the adoption of these terms makes English more scientale, more scientific. Defining these foreign words using English vocabulary, basic exposition, and simile and metaphor, Chaucer made new words like almicanteras part of English and vital to the pursuit of natural knowledge. With vivid imagery and very clear exposition, Chaucer renders these unfamiliar terms less daunting and more memorable to Lewis and other persons using this text as a guide. So for example, he embeds the definition of zenith, sanath, very possibly an unfamiliar word to his audience, into his description. The foresaid zenith is imagined to be the very point over the crown of the head. After telling his audience that the zenith is the point directly overhead, he uses two charming and illustrative similes to describe how azimuths intersect with almucantars. Rather than simply stating somewhat abstractly that they overlap one another, Chaucer explains, so from this zenith, as it seems, there comes a manner of crooked lines like to the claws of a spider or else like the work of a woman's caul, in curving over top the almacontras. And these same lines or divisions are called azimuths, and they divide the horizon of the astrolabe into 24 divisions. And these azimuths serve to know the height of the firmament and other conclusions, and for to know the zenith of the sun and of every star. So in a planispheric projection, the compass measurements, the azimuths, overlay the almacontars in such a way that they carve the surface of the astrolabe in shapes that resemble spider's claws or a finely woven caul. And I will say too that the comparison to a spider's claws is a classic comparison that is often used, but the comparison to a woman's caul is new. That seems to be an innovation of Chaucer's. And the manuscript tradition of the treatise bears out the newness of at least one of these new Arabic words. So the word zenith was so unfamiliar to some people who copied the treatise that the manuscript stemma includes two separate groups, alpha, 10 manuscripts, and beta, 8 manuscripts, that are distinguished by the replacement of zenith in the former to signet in the latter. So Arabic terms related to the astrolabe are not the only words that Chaucer introduced into English. He was also the first to use the term experience in English to refer specifically to a proof gained from a trial or practical demonstration. Now he first used experience in House of Fame in the sense of doing something concrete to test a theory. And then again, in the prologue to The Wife of Bath's Tale, where it has a slightly different meaning, there it means an event that one has taken part in and that has affected the subject. So this introduction of a new word to describe a way of gaining natural knowledge is another aspect of the Translatio Scientiae that Chaucer accomplishes here. In the treatise, Chaucer introduced the term with a particularly scientale connotation. Experience, using an instrument to test a particular theoretical premise, will lead to natural knowledge. He writes, another day I would know the degree of the sun, and this was at midday on the 13th day of December. I found the day of the month, the manner as I said, and I lay my rule upon this foresaid 13th day and found the point of my rule in the border upon the first degree of Capricorn, a little within the degree. And then had I of this conclusion the full experience. So in addition to this clear instruction, the use of the first person pronoun and the past tense enable the reader to follow clearly what Chaucer did step by step and provide the reader with a sense that this can be done because this has been done before. Chaucer writes as an instructor, providing the student with concrete guidelines in the first person. I found, then laid I. These clear steps lead to enlightenment. And thus I know the conclusion, or and then had I of this conclusion, the full experience. So here he presents experience as necessary to gaining knowledge about how to use the astrolabe and the knowledge it brings in turn. So knowledge from the senses, experience, is often contrasted with learned text-based knowledge and characterized in Middle English as lewd, meaning untutored or unlettered. By naming himself as a lewd compilator or an untutored compiler, Chaucer elevates untutored experiential knowledge and integrates it with learned text-based knowledge. So using an astrolabe allows the user to attain knowledge by doing, by experience, and he relies on this concept throughout the treatise. The purpose of the astrolabe is to get information about the location of celestial bodies, and this is vital natural knowledge that was used for prediction, medical practice, calendrical reckoning, all kinds of divination. The mention of experience in this passage reflects the importance of direct participation and observation in natural knowledge, including astral science in the 14th century. Existing emphasis on observation from the early medieval period became combined with more specific articulation, using experience in tandem with specialized instruments. And this is an idea that's first introduced into the Arabic tradition by scholars and authors, and then later gets translated into Latin and taken up in the 13th century. Sustained purposeful observation of astronomical phenomena, or what was called observatio, had been important throughout Latin Christendom for timekeeping purposes since late antiquity, and later for the observation needed for the cosmological knowledge and exact calculations for computus. But this notion of using experimentum or experience along with instruments arose in Latin Christendom in the 13th century, but it has its origins in the work of Arabic authors of the 11th century. Ibn al-Haytham introduced the notion of using a scientific instrument in a trial or proof to gain knowledge in his work on optics, the Kitab al-Munawwar. And this work, which was attributed in Latin to al-Hazen, was translated at the start of the 13th century as De Aspectibus. Ibn al-Haytham's concept of experimentatio, or in Arabic, i'atibar, as a test to investigate physical properties with the help of an instrument or apparatus that is designed for the purpose of carrying out that test, was taken up by Roger Bacon in the second half of the 13th century as he was developing his own theory of scientia experimentalis, a way of gaining natural knowledge that affirms and requires sense experience coupled with instruments. So according to Bacon, experience is really necessary to the full understanding of things, especially to confer certainty. For there are two modes of acquiring knowledge, he wrote, namely by reasoning and by experience. Reasoning draws a conclusion, but does not make the conclusion certain, nor does it remove doubt, so that the mind may rest in the understanding of truth, unless the mind discovers it by way of experience. He goes on to argue that one who had never seen fire would not truly understand its destructive power unless he stuck his hand in the flames. Thus, experience can round out learning or from texts or syllogisms. For if someone who has never seen fire should prove by adequate reasoning that fire burns and injures things and destroys them, his mind would not be satisfied thereby, nor would he avoid fire until he placed his hand or some combustible substance in the fire, so that he might prove by experience that which reasoning taught. But when he has had actual experience of combustion, his mind is made certain and rests in the full light of truth. Therefore, reasoning does not suffice, but experience does. And nor was Bacon an outlier. He was part of a really robust group of contemporaries in Paris and Oxford in the 13th century who took up this concept of experientia or experimentum in the context of natural knowledge. And Bacon's many texts on experience, instruments, and the political utility of natural knowledge circulated in university communities and learned courts throughout Europe in the 14th century. Regardless of whether Chaucer read Bacon, Chaucer's adoption of the term experience in conjunction with the astrolabe is distinctively Baconian. And although Chaucer was not the first to introduce the concept of experience into England, he was the first to introduce the word, meaning to mean the sort of demonstration or confirmation of a theory, into English. By insisting to the audience that the theory of the astrolabe, which is laid out in the treatise, needed to be read alongside the practical demonstration of the astrolabe for complete understanding, the full experience, as he says, of its use and application, right? Chaucer is affirming this view that direct participation, that doing, is necessary to really knowing. So in the treatise, Chaucer stakes a claim for English as a scientific language and a new way of making natural knowledge through experience as also English. Natural knowledge in 14th century England was increasingly available to a wider audience in keeping with these wider trends toward vernacularization, and also the contemporary kind of diminishment of the importance of French among the English elite. The pseudo-Aristotelian Book of the Secret of Secrets, the Secretum Secretorum, or as it was first known in Arabic, the Kitab Sir al-Asrar, was translated into English at least 9 times in the 14th and 15th centuries. Texts on medicine, botany, and astral science were translated into or composed in English as well. And astrolabes also became more common in the 14th century than it had been in earlier centuries in Latin Christendom, owned not only by university scholars, but by navigators, physicians, scholars, and wealthy elites. Addressing colloquial users or potential users of the astrolabe beyond the court, Chaucer self-consciously proposed a vernacular cosmology that makes English into a language of cultural prestige, a language for learning, gathering, and expressing knowledge about the cosmos. With the treatise, Chaucer translated Scientia into science, just as Wycliffite writers made the Bible into an English text. So there is no manuscript of the treatise, like complete manuscript, contemporary to its composition. And it's, as I said, possible that Chaucer wrote it in bits and pieces and that it was often copied that way at first. But of the, we have a variety of manuscripts. The complete manuscripts of it are from the 15th century. And the variety in those manuscripts really reveals the sort of clue, gives us clues to it, the treatise's reception. In over three quarters of the extant manuscripts that we have, the treatise was written in a formal or semi-formal book hand on parchment, and at least eight of the manuscripts contain diagrams like you see here, as well as rubrication, decorated initials, and flourishes in red, blue, and sometimes gold ink. The generally fine quality of these manuscripts suggests that the treatise, despite its address to a schoolboy, was not used as a school text. Furthermore, most of the manuscripts are bound in codices with Latin texts, suggesting that the owners of these manuscripts viewed the material in the treatise as essentially Latinate, despite Chaucer's perhaps best efforts. Thus, despite the fact that Chaucer was writing for an audience, as he says, whose Latin may have been somewhat small, not good enough to read Sacrobosco, Mashallah, or other works on planetary astronomy in Latin, the treatise was collected and very possibly used by people whose Latin was sufficient for reading. Virtually all of these Latin texts are on subjects that have to do with natural knowledge, including botany, alchemy, mathematics, astronomy, natural magic, chiromancy, we see here, anatomy, and medicine. Six of the manuscripts contain different versions of Sacrobosco's treatise on the sphere, Mashallah's treatise, and the calendars of Nicholas of Lynn and John Summer, who were initially supposed to be included in the treatise itself. The owners of these codices were perhaps using Chaucer's treatise as a crib for the Latin, or they may have been interested in having a more explicit introduction to the astrolabe and its uses. But also this kind of fine quality of these manuscripts and the fact that there's usually only this one English work that's bound in is perhaps an indication that Chaucer's work was collected by a population concerned with the prestige value of scientific knowledge as well as its utilitarian purposes. And in this way, Chaucer's treatise appears more like an object perhaps in a wonder cavern or the collection of telescopes in the early 16th century, a token of cultural capital or distinction in a society that was increasingly interested in astral science and natural knowledge, in which astrolabes are beautiful luxury objects instead of only scientific instruments. The treatise is often found with medical texts, Latin translations of Galen and Hippocrates, works on anatomy, works on uranoscopy, as well as recipes in Latin, and oftentimes the zodiac man too, a diagram for physicians, which makes clear the best times for certain medical procedures. Physicians used astronomy for their profession, or at least were expected to be seen to do so. The inclusion of medical works alongside the treatise suggests that physicians practicing in England may have used it to learn the astrolabe and thus gain a deeper understanding of celestial effects on human physiology. But these two audiences for Chaucer's treatise are not mutually exclusive. Physicians could be wealthy members of the bourgeoisie or courtiers and were just as aware of the importance of cultural capital as members of other professions. Even if a physician did not regularly consult the stars, he was expected to know how to do so, and Chaucer's treatise could be both a useful reference and a mark of distinction. Or it's possible that the audience for the treatise was bifurcated, with a group of collectors of natural knowledge whose ownership of scientific texts signaled their social status, and a group of working physicians who found the work on the astrolabe to be a useful addition to their libraries. Regardless, the wide circulation of the treatise and the comparatively fine production of the manuscripts suggests that Chaucer's attempts at Translatio Scientiae had been a success. A different, wider audience engaged with the astrolabe and its use and became ever more accustomed to using English as a scientific language. The appearance of the treatise alongside works on phlebotomy, divination, alchemy, and other experiential sciences demonstrates also that the readers of the treatise understood it as a text that considered experience as necessary to natural knowledge. So in the treatise on the astrolabe, Chaucer translates scientia into English and experience into scientia. Thank you very much.
I think we have a little bit of time for questions for our speaker. If there are any from online or not yet, or from the audience. Oh, I see a few hands. Maybe we'll start over here, David. And oh, I think, should we pass the microphone around?
Yes. Will they be able to hear it? Like, you might want to repeat the question.
I can repeat the question.
Or David, you can come to the microphone. Yes, sure. Why not?
Speak into the microphone, David.
Well, just to say thank you very much. It was just a fabulous lecture and so very helpful. I just thought of two brief things. Firstly, I'm reading Teaching Dante right now, and I'm very struck by the frequency with which he uses the word experience in the Inferno. And of course, for Dante, he didn't need to go all the way through hell, actually go through hell. He could have just read Virgil. Virgil was in Latin. But Virgil could say, no, you need experience of this. You need to feel the flames. You need to sort of talk to people. Mm-hmm. And Dante is certainly doing a translation exercise, Translatio Scientiae, into Italian of the kind of Chaucer. The second is the wife of Bath. It's beautiful. You've really rescued her from, you've made her into a scientist. She's a scientist of a particular wifely craft.
Yeah.
And I'll just say the word instrument supports beautifully what you're saying. Her uses the word instrument, which very few pilgrims do, of her body. So her laboratory is her body, which she calls it my instrument.
Thank you so much for that, both of those things. You know, I actually have wondered if when Dante is writing about experience, because Bacon's work was like quite taken up in both the papal curia, but then there's also evidence that it was taken up and used by painters in the sort of like early 14th century as well. And so I actually wonder if that's in part kind of seeps into Dante through there. And I'd love to look into that more. The wife of Bat, yeah, she's the, I mean, domestic science is real. we agree on it now.
Are there other questions? Yeah.
Yes, other questions?
Over there, if you wouldn't mind coming up to
just project.
Yeah. Okay.
I'll repeat it.
It's a bar in Arabic many times that in medieval, Islamic context, it's typically, sometimes it's often used as a rhetorical suggestion, if not actually experienced. So, or it would be improbable if, there were giraffes.
So like a thought experiment.
Yeah.
So the question is about like, to what extent is experience real or verifiable or material? And this question is about sort of how it becomes mobilized in thought experiments as well. And I absolutely see that in Arabic works, and we see it also in Latin and in European vernacular works, where the idea of that you could know something through imagining or thinking about it. And that sits kind of uneasily alongside other kinds of experience. But the idea about verification is really interesting, because one of the things that that I've noticed in the Latin context is that it really is about the subjectivity of the experiencer themselves. So only some people's experience is automatically seen as productive of knowledge. Other people's experience, like the wife of Bath, right, needs to be translated, usually by a man with a particular character and a particular sort of morality in order to become knowledge that could be called upon in some way. So that's it itself requires translation.
And a question from, oh.
Yeah. Sure.
Can you see the
camera? No.
How do you assess the proportion of parchment paper manuscripts for the Astrolabe? You mentioned it was 75% parchment. Do you find it as significantly higher than other scientific manuscripts in the 15th century?
So the question is about, right, is the question about are more things on parchment? I think that, so I guess what I would say is I don't find the breakdown of parchment to paper itself to be remarkable. You still come across a ton of scientific works written on parchment in this period, especially ones related to astral science or auxiliary to astral science as well. Yeah,
thanks. We had a question, I think, from Jack.
Yeah.
I was really struck by your point at the end about following this learning, I think those who are I wonder if there's a third as a piece of translation. Do you have any evidence in the 15th century books? Do you have any evidence of medieval books, study books, or science?
Yeah, that's a great question. So the question is about how are some of the people collecting this text themselves interested in it as an example of translation? And, you know, honestly, Jack, that's a great suggestion, and I have never thought of it, but I think the answer has to be yes, because because you see, right, like translations of Galenic texts, Hippocratic texts, sort of shorter versions of Masha'Allah, et cetera, it's very possible at least. So I would have to, but oftentimes it's the treatise is the only work of English in the codex, but it's not necessarily, and sometimes it's not the only work of translation, but I'd have to go back and check, but I haven't seen any copies where like everything is a translation necessarily, but that's a great, great point. Thank you for that. Yeah.
Time for maybe one more question.
Sure.
Please go ahead.
Yeah. Go for it.
My name is Alex. I just have a question about if you refer to this experience and, you know, the question of what Chaucer is doing in that passage, especially for his sort of saying he thought the whole experience would be after the right now. And is to sort of query, not that I know anything about this, know whether you're right or wrong, but you sort of emphasize the connection with Bacon rather than a sort of Sicilian tradition. And I'm sort of looking at this, it seems to me that it could in a way be correlated with that sort of that what we're trying to get is not knowledge of sort of the particular, sort of not doing an experiment to see if it works rather than we're sort of trying to get what, like, you know, so Avicenna has this three certain principles, right? The Aulier, for what certain premises to demonstrate the Aulier, then should be it, and what's the other one? The sensory stuff,
yeah.
Right? Whatever the, So there's a distinction between sensory, like what you sort of you observe versus what you sort of you say the idea with your school. Is this sort of could this be just trying to play with the astrolabe enough to make it part of your experience so that you have certain knowledge, like a knowledge of universals here, of like that the whole theory, this sort of whole built up theory is correct rather than a kind of like let's test the hypothesis and get, you know, and then sort of see whether it's right or wrong based on a kind of thought through test and assay.
Yes, sort of. Right. I see what you're getting at. Yeah, I think you're right in that, right, he's not thinking about using the astrolabe as a way in which in the sort of like modern scientific understanding of an experiment to kind of test a set of conclusions necessarily. But I think in part, this, the kind of messiness, though, this idea that knowledge and certainty, right, or affirmation in some way comes through experiential knowledge. I think there's a lot of overlap because those terms have a ton of overlap in them as well. But I think that what he does here is, so what here he's doing is, I think it could be, you know, as you say, a sort of more sense of, this is how you sort of internalize this knowledge essentially. But there are plenty of examples in the Astrolabe where he's sort of like, this is a problem and you test it, right? You can sort of test this with the Astrolabe. So I do think it is both. So the reproducibility, yes. And so exactly, like what he's saying here is that these results can essentially be reproduced if you just follow the step-by-step instructions. Yeah. I think we have to wrap it up now.
Yes, sadly. Yes. So please thank our speaker, Elly. And just a reminder for all of our participants here in person that we will meet tomorrow as of 9:30 a.m. There'll be coffee on the sixth floor of Van Pelt Library at Penn, and the proceedings will start promptly at 10 a.m. So we'll see you all there. Thank you for coming.
It's gonna be lit.
Thanks, everyone. If someone has left things in a locker in the variable department, we have an adventure ahead of us, but just let me know and we'll go get it.
Okay.